As a physician, I have to attend many meetings. I have to attend the conventional meetings as well as the unconventional meetings because I have to get all my brownie points for my medical license. And I just want to say that this, having sat through most of the lectures in this meeting, I have to say that this is more informative, this has been more informative than any of the professional medical meetings I have attended or any of the health organization meetings such as the National Health Federation. It is, the speakers are extremely high caliber, and I just can't say enough about this particular meeting and this particular organization. So I want to thank Lorraine many times for her work. I'm missing some of my material because I had the misfortune, or whatever you wish to call it, being called to testify for Jimmy Keller. I spent 3 days last week at his trial, and I'm deeply saddened, as I'm sure all of you are, with this verdict. I think it's extremely unfair, and I had hoped, cautiously hoped for an acquittal, but I, having been in federal court myself, I am very skeptical about the operation of our federal courts today. This judge, while seeming to be friendly and being somewhat favorable toward the defense, I'm certain now was acting as not sincere and not honest, and I just, anyway, I feel it's not over, however, and I think that Jimmy needs your help now more than ever. If you still have anything left to contribute, as one of the previous speakers has expressed, but I think we need to support him with all our might, because as one speaker has mentioned, if Jimmy does go down, it means that many of the rest of us are going to either be out of business, or we will be even more on the our clinics, alternative care will be even more on the line than it is already. As you may know, I have practiced alternative care, mostly for cancer, over about the last 18 years, at most of that time being on the California side of Lake Tahoe. I was attacked by the state of California twice, and they attempted to remove my medical license because of what I do. I did manage to keep my license in California, but I felt it prudent to move to the state of Nevada, which I did in 1980, and I have not been sorry. Nevada is considerably more favorable toward the use of alternative therapies. One of the things that is favorable in Nevada is a homeopathic law, which established in 1983 a board of homeopathy, which I was privileged to serve on. But this homeopathic law in Nevada allows some of us practitioners to use such things as electrodiagnosis, electrotherapy, and the various instruments such as the Rife instrument, the Accupath, the Intero, and so forth. So we have an edge on other states, particularly California, which is so restrictive that there are virtually no, or I should say very few, practitioners left in this state who dare to do the various modalities that you've heard about in this meeting. I do many of the things that are done in Mexico. I use Laetril, I use DMSO. I have been over that in my previous talks, and most of what I was going to tell you has already been expressed here. So I'm going to spend a little time on some of the newer concepts and the newer things that I have been able to learn, and some of the things that I've been able to do since my last time I was here, which was 2 years ago. One of the exciting things that has come along is a new test for cancer. It's called the AMAS test. It's that those letters stand for anti-malignant antibody in serum. This is a blood test. It's done in Boston by a laboratory called Oncolab. It is somewhere between 97% and 99% accurate, depending on which series you're talking about. Some of the other tests that have come along, such as the C125 antigen test, the C115, various numbers, antigen tests have been very disappointing. And these are conventional tests done by orthodox, so-called orthodox medicine. But they have been shown to be quite inaccurate and not very useful. They seem to be useful only in cases where there are very large tumors. Now, compared with that, with the conventional test, this new AMAS test detects not only small cancers, but will detect the presence or the tendency toward cancer as long as 7 years before clinical cancer appears. It I believe it's an extremely important discovery, in that it might even revolutionize the care of cancer in this country, because it may hopefully take the care of cancer away from this cancer establishment you've heard referred to, take it out of the hands of the medical monopoly or the cancer monopoly, and put it in the hands of the patient, which is where it belongs. You can, with this test, determine whether or not you need to make certain changes in your lifestyle and get on a preventive program long before there is clinical cancer. At the same time, it is still useful in following various cancers, in following the success of your therapy. It is an extremely useful tool to me, particularly in cancers that are not measurable, or cancers that you can't measure any other way. Now, some, such as prostate cancer, you can measure with the PSA, you can measure with various things such as ultrasound, but the cancers that are difficult to follow can be followed with this test. It is a blood test, right? And if you're interested, the name of the lab is Oncolab, O-N-C-O-L-A-B. Onco means tumor, and their phone number is 1-800-9-CA-TEST, T-E-S-T. That's their phone number. The phone number is 1-800-9-CA-TEST. Okay. Well, as for material regarding the test, of course the test has to be drawn by a laboratory, and most laboratories insist that it be ordered by a doctor. Now, So far, I've gotten considerable cooperation with other physicians, straight guys, you know, the regular AMA types, in getting this test done once they learn a little bit about it. So you can obtain material from Oncolab, present it to your doctor, ask him if he'll do the test. It's about $150, which is not cheap, of course, but compared with other testing such as CT scans, mammograms, and so forth, it's very, very competitive and much more accurate. It has been done in England now. It is being done in England now as screening for cancer of the breast. And it is considered the preferred method of testing for cancer of the breast in England. It's approved by the National Health Service in England and is paid for by the National, of course they pay for everything, but it is considered in England to be superior to the mammogram, and I believe it is far superior to the mammogram as far as detecting breast cancer. It does not locate the cancer. It's an antibody test. Now, many of you know, whenever you get a disease, whether it's infectious disease or cancer, there are antibodies that are specific for that disease that are produced by the body. The cancer is no different in that respect from infectious diseases. Cancer calls forth specific antibodies that help the body to fight the cancer. And this is simply a measurement of those antibodies that are specific for malignant tumors. I'm going to take questions later, so let's move on here. I use a dark field microscope. You've heard about that from Dr. Privatera. We use that routinely with our cancer patients because it is a quick and efficient evaluation of the immune system. It tells us whether white blood cells are active, whether they are weak, whether the immune system is weak. Usually, in the case of cancer, the immune system is definitely weakened, and we can see that on the dark field microscope. It's almost a fluorescent type of a picture that we put up on a little TV screen that the patient can watch. And we see a number of, we can determine a number of things with this instrument. This particular instrument was discovered in the 30s in Germany and has recently been resurrected. It was initially used just to detect the spirochete of syphilis, but there are now about 1,000 of these instruments being used in this country for this particular purpose, that is to determine nutritional status and the status of the immune system. As you saw with Dr. Privatera's talk, it also tells us about platelet aggregation, which is the early stage of hardening of the arteries. The platelet aggregation is also present in cancer, and I believe that there is a relationship between cancer and arteriosclerosis, as does Dr. Privatera and a number of others who have been in this in this business for a long time. We can detect toxicity, various specific vitamin deficiencies and mineral deficiencies with this with this method of testing. It's, as I say, it's not new, but we have come upon a new use, and I believe a much broader and more important use than simply looking for spirochetes. Since my last talk here, which was 2 years ago, I have begun to use some of these other modalities that you've been hearing about. One of them is shark cartilage. I use that just about routinely now. As you've heard, it is It has a specific effect on tumors by reducing the blood supply to tumors. It's the so-called anti-angiogenic factor. I feel that we're getting better results using this material. I have found Immucin C to be useful. Just recently came upon this as an anti-cancer substance. It is unique in that it is capable of killing cancer cells without hurting normal cells, and this is unheard of as far as chemotherapeutic drugs are concerned. Of course, all of them, as we well know, are very injurious to the immune system. This material not only doesn't harm the immune system, it helps it by boosting T cell activity. Oxygen, of course, you've heard about oxygen, I have just begun to get into that modality. One other test I might mention is the natural killer cell activity test. There is another way of measuring the immune system by determining the activity of NK cells. This is done by a laboratory here in the LA area. It's becoming more conventional. We do not only lymphocyte counts, but we measure the activity of the natural killer cells. And this is fairly new also. It's another way of looking at the immune system, of course, and measuring progress in this area. I'd like to talk a little bit, of course you've heard all kinds of, almost everyone here talking about the immune system. I would like to go over some of the functions of the physiology of the immune system. If I could show a few slides here, I'm not going to bore you with a lot of scientific detail. You've had plenty of that. Dr. Ronsberger probably had the most detailed explanation, and my only problem with that is that it was so detailed that I had trouble understanding some of it, and I'm sure you had some trouble too. I do use quite a bit of thymus. The thymus is the regulator, the field general of the immune system. These are the various organs that are involved in the immune system. The base of the brain or the hypothalamus. Oh, got to back up here a little bit. Oh, thank you. No. I'm trying to go backwards here. Is that focused? You see that? Okay. I'll just go through this briefly, and I will. I think I can manage this from here. Thank you. The brain, the base of the brain called the hypothalamus, influences the thymus. I pushed something, I guess. The thymus, in turn, you've already heard, is the organ which influences the activity of the T cells. That's why they're called T cells, because they are thymus directed. The bone marrow, of course, produces. Is this automatic? Is that? I'm not pushing anything. Pardon? I'm not touching it. At any rate, I'll go on here. I'm going to put it down and prove it to you. anyway, I'm going to go through this quickly anyway. You've heard all about the...
Okay, you've got your
okay. Thank you. You've heard about most of this and I don't need to go through it in detail, but there, all of these organs are orchestrated and all exert an influence on what we call the immune system. One speaker said there is no such thing as an immune system. It's an orchestration of many systems, and I think that's probably a good definition. You'll see here the at the top of this slide, the word stress. Stress is, of course, only one thing that that has an adverse effect on the immune system, and I might talk about that for a moment. Most people, I believe, who develop cancer have had an excessive exposure to stress, whether it's external or internal. They tend to be people who are very conscientious. They tend to be meticulous type people who take on the world's burdens on their own shoulders, and they're not the kickback types. They are susceptible to stress, and this in turn negatively influences the immune system, and we can see that in our testing. We can see that in the activity of white blood cells, that all of this stress has a very negative effect on the immune system, of course, as do many other things, as we'll see shortly, and of course chemicals and so forth. But this is a kind of a cartoon showing that the cells, of course, are produced. White blood cells are produced by the bone marrow. They are, when they come out of the bone marrow, they are what we call pluripotent cells. That is, they are capable of becoming T cells, B cells, neutrophils or granulocytes, various types of white blood cells. The lymphocytes in this situation are the most important of these white blood cells, and they in turn are differentiated into helper cells, memory cells, and killer T cells. They have various functions, and as the name implies, of course, helper T cells are the ones who help the killer T cells attack their target. Macrophages are the large phage cells, which are often the first on the scene in any infection or in cancer or any other abnormal condition. These are orchestrated, and they talk to each other by means of chemicals called peptides. Peptides are, in this case, they're short chain amino acid complexes. They're made up of amino acids. And they signal to one another. They say, here is the enemy, and the memory cell recognizes this cell as a cancer cell. He tells the helper T cell, who in turn notifies the killer T cells to attack. You'll see here IL-1, IL-2, that represents interleukin 1 and 2, which you've heard about, and IF represents interferon. These are all peptides which influence this immune response, and of course the macrophage is part of this response, and participates in the recognition as well as in the phage or the devouring of abnormal forms. This is a diagram of what happens to our thymus gland as we get older. As when we're born, of course, the thymus gland is large and very active. After the first year of life, the thymus begins to get smaller and secrete less of the thymus hormones, the various substances that influence that process I just showed you, influence T cells and so forth. So as we get older, we have less influence from the thymus gland and less vigor in our immune systems, and that is one of the reasons why we are subject to the degenerative diseases. This is a macrophage. I just wanted to show you what a real macrophage looks like. It doesn't have a smiling face, but it's capable of reaching out and devouring bacteria, viruses, and cancer cells. This large irregular form is a cancer cell which is being attacked by killer T lymphocytes, and this is what's left of the sort of the skeleton of a cancer cell after it has been devoured by T cells. This is a demonstration of the various things that help in the cellular immune response. Thymus, of course, we've talked about that, which activates T cells, causes the immune reaction to go in the right direction. These various peptides we've talked about, spleen, brain, liver. Vitamin A is a very important factor in the development of a healthy and maintenance of a healthy immune system. It's been known for a long time that vitamin A plays a crucial role in this process. Vitamin C, of course, B1, B6 should be in there too, cysteine, and lymphokines, which are cell substances that's actually included in the those are peptides also. Those are the substances that one lymphocyte uses to talk to another lymphocyte, to tell one of these lymphocytes that there is an enemy present and to attack. The other part of the immune system is called the humoral part, or the antibody part of the immune system, which is mediated by B cells or B lymphocytes. These are influenced, of course, or they utilize antibodies. Some of the methods of treating or enhancing this reaction, this process, are autogenous vaccine, which is done by a number of clinics, and I have I've begun to get into that field also. Vaccine that's been made either from tumor or from the patient's own serum. Staph age lysate is a substance taken from the staphylococcus, and various antibodies, homeopathic sarcodes, and BCG. About the end of my rope, I guess. This is an incomplete list of the immune enhancers on the left, vitamin A, thymus factors, most of these things we've already talked about, shark cartilage and so forth. The suppressors we all know about, the things that suppress the immune system, are chemotherapy. I put number one. I think it's the most potent suppressor of the immune system. Stress, corticosteroids, cortisone, radiation, surgery, trauma. Chemicals, of course, we all know about chemicals, pesticides and so forth. Infections, antibiotics, antibiotics, and any medication. We see evidence on the dark field of this activity all the time. We can see whenever someone has had a pill of any kind within the previous 48 hours or so. It's very evident. And of course, alcohol, caffeine, and all those drugs. Now, I'm not really, I guess I'm finished. I had some patient slides, but I'm going to skip those, and I'll answer any questions you might have. Yes, sir. They're glandulars, yes. Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, the dark field microscope. The question was, will you describe the dark field microscope and how it works? It's like a regular microscope, except that the source of light comes in at an angle, a 45-degree angle, and it bounces off live blood cells. See, when you do a regular blood count, you stain the cells, and they're all dead, of course. But with this, you use fresh blood. You have to have the patient there. That's very bright. Characterized by proliferation of white blood cells, depending upon which type. Lymphocytic leukemia is the most common. It is a fairly easy condition to deal with. That is chronic leukemia, not acute. Yes, in people with degenerative disease, the substances which seem to help are hydrochloric acid and niacin in that situation. Yes? I have a private practice. I don't know whether I can call it a clinic, being a one-man office, but some people call it a clinic. That's quercetin. I don't use quercetin now.
We're now 5.5 minutes over.
Okay. I got to quit.